Hello friends, welcome to Smart News Digital. Today, let's see the current affairs of 10th August 2018. The news items we'll be covering today are this 6. Apart from this 6, the anti-trafficking bill was also repeated in the news, for which you can refer the current affairs of past 1 week. The first news article is with respect to withdrawal of FRDI bill by the government. The withdrawal of the bill shows the extent of the public opposition to the bill and the recognition of the public opposition by the government. The FRDI bill stands for Financial Resolution and Deposit Insurance Bill, which was introduced in the Parliament in the year 2017. The bill covers the bankruptcy provisions of the businesses such as banks. Recently, the bankruptcy provision of banks was constantly in news because of the rising NPA issue and also many defaulters fleeing countries such as Vijay Mallya. One of the clause of the bill, namely bail-in clause, faced the fiercest criticism from the general public. The bail-in clause regulates the survival of the bank by absorbing the capital in order to resist the losses faced by the bank. Here, the survival of the bank is at the cost of the depositor's money. So, the survival does not mean the safety of depositor's money, but it means the restoration of the capital of the bank at the cost of depositor's money. The bail-in clause also proposed a resolution cooperation in order to suspend all the liabilities owned by the bank with respect to the money in the savings or the FD accounts. So, on a whole, the bail-in clause means that the banks can simply refuse to repay the customers' hard-earned money and instead issue securities such as preference share. This whole issue created a widespread criticism on the government's stand on introducing the bill in the parliament. After facing such fierce criticism, the government responded that resolution of this issue is at most need and a comprehensive examination and reconsideration of the bill is necessary before tabling it again in the parliament. We all know that the banking sector occupies a very important place in the economic system of the country, and a banking failure can pose a threat to overall stability of the finances in our country. So this opportunity is provided to the government in order to review the existing framework for resolving the bankruptcy scenarios among the financial entities in the country. With respect to the review of the current situation, two main ideas must be kept in mind by the review committee. The first one is the evaluation of the progress made by the Insolvency and the Bankruptcy Code, which was formulated in the year 2016. And the second is strengthening of deposit insurance and credit guarantee cooperation. We need to know about both of these provisions. First one is Insolvency and the Bankruptcy Code 2016. So this code was set up in order to provide a speedy resolution to the stressed asset in the country in various banks. This provision is applicable both to individuals, partnership, limited liability partnership, as well as the corporations. The code resolves to provide a timely resolution to the problem by fixing a time frame of 180 days, which can be extended by a period of 90 days. It also provides a fast track process of 90 days with respect to some specific entities. The Insolvency and the Bankruptcy Code also establishes a National Company Law Tribunal in order to regulate the issues with respect to the corporations, and a Debt Recovery Tribunal in order to deal with the issues concerning individuals and the partnership firms. Now let's see with respect to Deposit Insurance and Credit Guarantee Cooperation. This institution was set up in early 1960s in the aftermath of the collapse of two national banks in order to guarantee the repayment of the bank deposits. The bank deposits up to the cost of 1 lakh is covered by the bank, and this 1 lakh amount is not renewed after the year 1993. Due to inflation in the current economy, this 1 lakh amount no longer holds its original position, hence there needs a review. This insulation provided by DICGC is not only with respect to Indian banks, but it also encompasses the foreign functioning banks in India, The local area banks, the cooperative banks, and also regional rural banks functioning within a country. The above discussed the concerns called for the immediate review for the FRDI bill, and this is essential especially when people's faith in the bank is very low, and especially the state-run public sector banks are severely stressed because of bad loans. The second issue we are covering today is with respect to Article 35A. This Article 35A and various Supreme Court judgments with respect to Article 35A was continuously in news for past 1 week. You can refer to the past week news videos in order to understand the current debate with respect to Article 35A. This editorial provides some historical insights or historical facts with respect to Article 35A, which can be used for the mains answer writing. Article 35A is with respect to the special status given to both state and the people of Jammu Kashmir state. According to few critics, this Article 35A gives undue powers with respect to the state and the people of Jammu Kashmir, and it prevents other non-state residents to buy land in the state. This is against the right to equality, which is a part of the basic structure of Indian Constitution and a part of our fundamental rights. This Article 35A was not original part of our Indian Constitution. It was introduced via a presidential order in the year 1954 in order to provide a special status to the state. But contradictory to the commonly perceived belief that Article 35A is to provide autonomy to the state, but it was actually intended to take away the autonomy which was present with the state of Jammu Kashmir. By this presidential order, for the first time, the fundamental rights and the directive principles of state policy was applicable to the whole of Jammu Kashmir, and the state's finances were integrated with the state finances of the nation India. The presidential order also extended the jurisdiction of Supreme Court over certain aspects of Jammu Kashmir. This order was celebrated in the year 1954 as a historical step in order to bring Jammu Kashmir closer to India. These provisions, which were proposed in the year 1954, after many decades, is creating confusion now because of the conceived notion as special state with respect to India. Let's go further down in the history. The instrument of accession was signed by Maharaja Hari Singh in the year 1947 with the state of India in order to give New Delhi the control of Kashmir's defense, foreign policy, and communication. All the other matters, the Jammu Kashmir government retained the powers with respect to all the other matters. So if we create a spectrum and place a completely integrated state of Bihar on one end and a completely sovereign country Bhutan with limited protection under India on the other, Jammu Kashmir lies somewhere in between. This 1947 accession weakened the constitutional link between India and Kashmir. The accession also gave the state its own constituent assembly, its own flag, and also the Supreme Court of India do not have complete jurisdiction over key issues in the state of Jammu Kashmir. It also constituted a separate Kashmir military force, and Srinagar also tried to send its own commissioners to foreign missions. That was a scenario with respect to 1947 accession. However, our constitution came into place in the year 1950, and the powers between the state of Jammu Kashmir and India, that is New Delhi, was well defined in another presidential order which was given in the year 1950. This presidential order is different from the presidential order of 1954, which created Article 35A. According to this presidential order, India's fundamental rights and directive principles of state policy were not applicable at all to state of Jammu Kashmir. There was further talks between this government of India and the government of Jammu Kashmir, which culminated in Delhi Agreement of 1952. However, the Delhi Agreement did not lead to any financial integration or any required amendments to the fundamental rights and the citizenship provisions granted to the state's residents via the state's legislature. Finally, in the year 1954, after further negotiations, the Kashmir Constituent Assembly was convened in February, and finally, the Article 35A was introduced as a part of the presidential order. By this presidential order, all the residuary powers are rested with the state with respect to Jammu Kashmir. However, with rest of India, the residuary power is with respect to the centre. Provision also created some of controversial norms, like the state government could detain people who did not enjoy any right to appeal in the Supreme Court, and also it can introduce some controversial reforms with respect to alteration of the state boundaries. What we saw till now is with respect to the history. Currently, Article 35A is in use in order to see its validity with respect to the larger part of the integration of the state of Jammu Kashmir with respect to rest of India. Any nation building process in a democratic country like India must involve negotiation between the nation state and its components. Components here is the state, particularly the Jammu Kashmir state. So, in order to remove the Article 35A, negotiation is needed with respect to the people of Jammu Kashmir state, and no unilateral decision should be brought forward by the centre. The third issue we are going to see today is with respect to the Supreme Court altering Lodha Committee's proposals on the BCCI reforms. The Lodha Committee was constituted to bring in reforms to the BCCI institution, and it submitted its report in the year 2016. Now, the Supreme Court approved the final new draft constitution of the BCCI with few changes. Let's see some of the changes brought in by the Supreme Court now. The Lodha Committee proposed one state, one oath, which means each state of our country can give one oath, and it provided all the states equal voting rights. However, the recent Supreme Court verdict did not accept this one state, one vote concept, and it ensured that certain states like Maharashtra and Gujarat will retain its full membership. There was another clause called as cool off period, which was changed by the Supreme Court verdict. The cool off period is the time gap between one term and the other, which must be provided in order to ensure accountability in the functioning of the leader. Previously, the Lodha Committee recommended after each term of the leader, there must be a cool-off period. However, after the SC verdict, after two consecutive terms, there will be a cool-off period instead of one. There is also a change brought in with respect to membership in the BCCI. According to Lodha Committee recommendations, no full membership will be given to association with no state entity. That is, only the state entities can have membership with respect to the BCCI. However, the SC verdict changed it. It gave certain services like Railway Association and Association of Indian Universities will have full membership with respect to the BCCI. There is also a change in tenure of the post. According to Lodha Committee recommendation, a leader can hold a post up to only 9 years either at BCCI or state associations totally, but the Supreme Court verdict is still yet to decide on the total tenure of the post. The Supreme Court verdict is also pending with respect to the age gap of the leader of the BCCI. Because of the reforms brought in by the Supreme Court, the Apex Governing Council of BCCI for the first time will have an all-round representation, including from the former players and the women cricketers. The BCCI is also set to come under the provisions of Right to Information Act, which will introduce more transparency in functioning of the BCCI organization. The next issue we are seeing today is with respect to the changes proposed by the cabinet in the Triple Talaq Bill. The Union Cabinet approved three crucial changes to the amendments of the Triple Talaq Bill. The Triple Talaq Bill is tabled in the name Muslim Women Protection of Rights on Marriages Bill, and it imposes 3 years jail term and provides other safeguard in order to protect the Muslim women. The first change proposed by the cabinet is with respect to non-bailable clause. It retained the stand that the police cannot grant bail at the police station. However, the accused can approach a magistrate for bail even before the trial. This is in order to protect some unfair complaints against few individuals. This chart shows a survey done in the states of Maharashtra, Gujarat, West Bengal, Tamil Nadu, Rajasthan, Jharkhand, Odisha and Bihar. It involved almost 5,000 women. According to survey, it states that the triple talaq is used against 73% of the women who are from poor background who earn almost less than 50,000 rupees annually. 47% of the women have more than 2 children, and 55% of them who face the triple talaq situation are married below the age of 18 years. It also states that 92% of the women want a ban on triple talaq, and 91% of them are against the concept of polygamy practiced in Islam. The second change brought in by the cabinet is with respect to registration of FIR, that is, first information report can be filed only by the victim's wife or the blood relation or the relations by marriage. Therefore, any outside agency or neighbors initiating the FIR is ruled out now. The third change brought in by the cabinet is, it made the issue of triple talaq compoundable. That is, it brought in for the first time magistrate in solving the issues with respect to the triple talaq. The magistrate can even call the both the parties and withdraw the cases by negotiating between them. The fifth issue we are going to see today is with regarding the issue of environment. The ministry rejects low score on green health. The World Economic Forum ranked India at 177 out of 180 nations in its Environmental Performing Index 2018. This ranking is almost 36 points down from its 2016 ranking of 141. This Environmental Performing Index is produced by WEF with the help of Yale and Columbia University. The Environmental Performing Index rankings are dominated by European countries like Switzerland, France, Denmark occupying the first three positions. India is occupying one of the bottom three positions with a rank of 177. The index also states that India is one of the bottom countries with respect to the air quality in different cities. The parameters with which the Environmental Performing Index is providing its ranking is air quality, water and sanitation, heavy metals and exposure to heavy metals, biodiversity and habitat, forest and its recover losses, fisheries, climate and energy, that is carbon dioxide, methane emissions, etc., air pollution, SO2 and NO2 emissions specifically, water resources and agriculturally sustainable practices. According to Forest and Climate Change Ministry, this slip in the rank is due to the change in parameters and not due to degradation of environment in our country. The final issue we are going to see today is with respect to criminalization of politics. Criminals in politics leave SC anguished. The Chief Justice of India is presiding over a 5-judge constitutional bench in order to hear the petitions to bar the politicians who are facing charges, that is accused of heinous crimes such as murder, rape, kidnapping, from contesting in election. This petition seeks to ban the politicians who are accused of heinous crimes from contesting in election at both central and the state level. However, at the same time, the Supreme Court also insisted that the court can only declare a law, the parliament can only make a law. That is, it is the duty of the legislature to make a law. The Representation of People's Act in our country has provisions with respect to the politicians who are convicted of heinous crimes. However, the Representation of the People's Act disqualifies only convicted lawmakers and not those who are accused of committing heinous crimes. The Supreme Court also insisted that setting up of fast-track courts in order to deal with the criminalization in politics is only solution for this issue. It also insisted that the Whistleblowers Protection Act in our country is too weak and it does not provide adequate protection to the families of the whistleblowers. Because of this, many cases are kept pending for a long time as the whistleblowers do not testify, and it increases the longevity and the duration of the cases pending. The provisions of 8, 1, 2, 3 and 4 of the Representation of People's Act talk about the disqualification of the lawmakers with respect to the heinous crimes in our country. Thank you.